praise the Lord, a very good night to all. We know that our Redeemer does live. And it is because he lived that we have the opportunity to come here tonight and share with you. And we have a very special guest with us tonight. We thank God so very much for having Sister Margaret Leslie Campbell to be here with us to share with us a wonderful message from God's word. It was love alone. And this, it has me thinking, what can this be all about? It was love alone. So before we get into her message tonight, I'm going to invite us to have a word of prayer. And then we're going to have an item of special music as we settle in. And then we're going to hand over to her to listen to what she has to say to us tonight. Pray with us at this point. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this opportunity that we can spend time in your courts of praise. And though we are in different locations, yet we are one in the spirit. I ask of you in the name of Jesus that you would bring us together. And I ask of you that you would place words in Sister Margaret's mouth, that the words would drop from her lips into our hearts and to live lives of victory, getting to know you better and to love you even more. So bless us, dear Lord, as we go into this session tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. There's a particular song that I love so much, and I love to hear it by any artist at all. And this song, you know, it shows me how weak I really am and how much I am in need of Jesus as a savior. And just recently, a very good friend of mine came and he recorded this song for me, he and his son. This is a song, and you know it very well. It is a song, I Can't Even Walk. And you may tire of it. I would never get tired of this song. This is by Brother Andrew Jordan and his son O'Neill, I Can't Even Walk. Let us listen to that song.
I thought I could be what I wanted.
Look at that smile. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. What a smile. And I am so thankful that Brother Andrew came in and he actually recorded that song for me. I hope that there is some young lady out there that would be able to sing. I would like to hear it in a female's voice at some point of time. I can't even walk, because it is not only men who cannot walk unless they're holding the hands of Jesus. All right. So I'm looking forward for a young lady to record that song so that we can play and enjoy. At this time then, I am going to hand over to Sister Margaret. It is so good to see you, Margaret. I trust that God will place all of the words in your mouth that you can speak to us tonight. Let me spotlight you as I bring you on.
Hello, good evening.
Hi, good evening.
Well, you did ask for, if you didn't see a young lady, I would have offered to sing the song for you.
Oh. Well, you fit the category.
Okay, good evening. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
And it is so great to be here to present to you a bit about God and His love. I have such an appetite for this topic, and as you would know, it was the understanding of His character that actually brought me close to Him. And I truly do believe that it is a message for the end time. Hence, I just research it. I just love it. So tonight I'm going to share with you. Tonight I want to share with you. I've been reading some information, and I just thought it was so exciting. I just want to share a bit with you. Of course, it is what I'm sharing with you is just the surface. It's so deep, and it is so beginning of the book kind of thing. So, but I just want to share, and I hope that you are blessed, as I was blessed, even as I only just started the book. Just let's go ahead for a short word of prayer. Father in heaven, I'm so thankful that you have brought me here to share. And as I do that, Father, I pray for you, your humility. I pray for your Holy Spirit to speak through me, and that others hearing the word may be blessed. I thank you. Amen. All right, I have titled this presentation, It Is Love Alone. And the first question I would want to ask is, if God is love, why is there so much suffering on earth? When you look at the horrendous events, the evils that occur daily on our planet. We have child abuse, rape, suicide, genocide, homicide, suicides. And then we have the not so subtle evils. We have slavery, we have extortion, we have economic rape of vulnerable countries. The list is exhausting. And there are those who have become atheists and those who've actually lost faith because they cannot believe in the existence of their God, who is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnibenevolent, a God who is all-powerful, all-knowing, and ever, ever so good. How could such a God allow these things to happen? So tonight we're going to do a little exploration of this. Now, knowing God, knowledge of God, and understanding Him is very important. John 17:3 reads, "And this is life eternal, that they might know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom Thou hast sent." So we have to know Him, and that's the only way we're going to really understand Him, and that's the only way we're going to even love Him. And God has made, He has given us, He has made provision for us to obtain this knowledge. Revelation 18:1, it reads, And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. So God has sent an angel with a message of his character of love for us. So he's given us the information that we can learn about him and his great love. Now the angel came down from heaven having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. What is God's glory? And if we can turn to Exodus 33:18-19, and it is a familiar text. 18, and he said, that is Moses speaking, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And he said, this is God speaking, I will make all my goodness pass before thee. So his goodness is equated to his glory. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And then Exodus 34:5-7. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him, Moses, there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the name of the Lord, name also synonymous with his character. So he proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means pay. So here God is showing Moses his glory, his goodness, his name. So, if God is love, again, I ask the question, why is there so much suffering on earth? And people ask this so often, and they come up with all kinds of reasons. They come up with, you know, he should not have made man with the ability to sin. He should not have put the tree in the Garden of Eden, that Adam could have been tempted. They have a lot of reasons why God did not do it the right way. But God did it the right way. Now, I want to turn to some texts in the Bible. I will just read them for you. I was hoping that I could share them on the screen, but I can't have this time. And I want to show you how the men of God in the Bible spoke about this evil, because they were so, it was surrounding them. They saw it. They saw how prevalent it was. They saw how wicked seemed to flourish, and they wrote about it. Job 9:24, for those of you who are actually turning. The earth is handed over to the wicked. He covers the faces of its judges. If he isn't the one doing this, who is? That's Job speaking. Isaiah 59:9-11 reads, that is why justice is far from us and righteousness doesn't reach us. We hope for light, but we walk in darkness. We hope for brightness, but we walk in gloom. We hope for justice, but there's none. We hope for salvation, but it's far from us. So this person, Isaiah is here speaking where you're not seeing God's goodness. It just seems so remote from us. Job 30:20-21-26 reads, I call to you for help, but you don't answer me. I stand up, but you just look at me. You have begun to treat me cruelly. With your mighty hand, you assault me. You pick me up and let the wind carry me away. You toss me around with a storm. I know you will lead me to death, to the dwelling place appointed for all living beings. When I waited for good, evil came. And when I looked for light, darkness came. Ecclesiastes 3:16. I saw something else under the sun. There is wickedness where justice should be found. There is wickedness where righteousness should be found. And the same book, Ecclesiastes 4:1-3. Next, I turn to look at all the acts of oppression that make people suffer under the sun. Look at the tears of those who suffer. No one can comfort them. Their oppressors have all the power. No one can comfort those who suffer. I congratulate the dead who have already died, rather than the living who still have to carry. But the person who hasn't been born yet is better off than both of them. He hasn't seen the evil that is done under the sun. And that is a very powerful test there, showing the evil that's done. And the oppressors, those who are oppressing us, they seem to have all the power. Jeremiah 12:1 reads, "Oh Lord, even I would argue my case with you. You would always be right. Yet, I want to talk to you about your justice. Why do wicked people succeed? Why do treacherous people have peace and quiet? You plant them and they take root. They grow and they produce fruit. They speak well of you with their lips, but their hearts are far from you." Habakkuk 1:13, the last part says, "Why are you silent when wicked people swallow those who are more righteous than they are?" And the last one, Psalm 13:1-2, "How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long would you hide your face from me? How long must I make decisions alone with sorrow in my heart day after day? How long will my enemy triumph over me?" So here we have some text that gives us an idea of the misery, the pain, the suffering that were experienced back in the day of those men of God. And it hasn't changed. Today, we still have a lot of suffering. Matter of fact, I might dare say that it is more because the world is getting worse. Sin is on the increase. And I would dare say that suffering for some of God's people is even worse. And they will be wondering, where is God now that I need him? I have this friend, Richard, and he kind of always tickles me with this every now and then. And we've had these really deep conversations. And Richard believes that God should not have made man a free moral being. He thinks that God should have made us a little higher than animals, who we thought have no choice, but with no freedom. And I said to him, I always say to him, God cannot do that. He has to make us with freedom of choice. That's how he is. That is love. And we have these conversations going. And he is not alone. There are many persons who believe that God, I've heard one person say that God actually set up Adam to fail. Because if he hadn't done that is, set up Adam to fail, why would he have put the tree there? If he didn't want him to fail, he should never have put that tree there. But that tree represented, again, the freedom of choice which God gives us. And at that tree, Adam had to choose. And he made the wrong decision. You see, it is important to understand God's involvement with evil. How I understand God's involvement, how you understand God's involvement with evil, will have a direct effect on how I process my experience with evil and suffering, and it will therefore affect the way I behave. So if I feel that God is responsible for this horrendous event, if I feel God could have done differently and he refused to answer me, if I feel all these negative about God, when or if I have to experience suffering, then I blame God, and that will intensify. I will not be able to heal internally. So we have to understand God's involvement with evil. Under that, our psychological experience is intensified, if we even believe it's God's fault. And I find I thought that was a very interesting thought. And I remembered a story that I heard listening to Ty Gibson, one of my favorite Character God presenters. And he gave the story of a lady, which I will call Anna because I don't really remember her name. But Anna, Ty had a series of presentations going on, and Anna would come every night and she would listen to Ty present. And then one day she went to him and said to him, you know, Ty, I would like you to come and meet my son. He said, okay, well, you know, I will come. But as he got caught up with the, you know, the week of his presentations, time went by and he didn't get an opportunity to go and see Anna's son. So Anna came back to him and said, you know, Ty, I really would like you to meet my son. He said, well, all right, well, why don't you invite your son to the meeting and I will get to meet him? And she said, well, I can't invite him. So then he was thinking something was physically wrong. He could, you know. So he asked her, well, why not? And she said, because he is incarcerated. He's in jail. Okay, I'm so sorry to hear. What did he do? He said, well, he killed my son. So now Ty is real confused. So you mean that your son who's in jail, let's call him John killed his brother? You know, and she's thinking, well, to lose two sons at the same time must be so terrible. She said, no, he didn't kill his brother, he killed my son. So Ty now is really, really, really confused. What do you mean? Well, John, who's in jail, he's not my biological son. He killed my son, my biological son. And I decided that I was going to visit him. And Anna visited John in jail, and John resented it. He pushed her off, and she persisted. And she showed John such love. That, for her, was healing. She was showing God. That was healing. And she embraced John as her son. And she said to him, you deprived me of my real son, so you now have got to be my son. And he and her developed that mother-son relationship. And her other children, they were not pleased, they resented it, but that was how she dealt with her pain, by loving the one who caused that pain. And in so doing, she showed Christ. So in this presentation, we want to show that God is extremely good and all powerful, despite the evils of the world. So I will do it in form of questions, and at any time, well, after, you can even ask me to go back to questions if you want to add something or seek an explanation. So the first question that I want to pose is this. If God is so good, he detests evil and does not want to see it around. And if he is so powerful, it means he can prevent it from happening. So why is there so much evil around? Why does he not prevent it from happening? And it all comes down to two words. Free choice. God created creatures, his creatures, with freedom of choice. So he made us free to choose good, he made or evil. He does not interfere with our choice. Some creatures will do what God desires, and some will not do what God desires, and that's evil. So evil, therefore, results when creatures misuse their free will and go contrary to what God desires. And this is what happened with the angels in heaven. And that's what happened with Adam in the garden. And that's what happened with us. We misused that freedom of choice and then evil results. So therefore, one can say that God is responsible for the possibility of evil, but not for the actuality of evil. What do I mean by that? Because God made us free to choose, there was always the possibility that the evil will, you know, one of the creatures or creatures will choose evil. There's all that possibility where he made us. But when we decide that we're going to do evil, then we are the ones who have actualized that evil. We're the ones who have done the evil. We're the ones who are responsible for the evil and not God. He just gave us the freedom to choose. We chose incorrectly, and we are the ones who have done the evil and not God. And that we must stress. Because he must create beings who are morally good, who can be good, and who can be evil. And God cannot give freedom to do evil and at the same time prevent creatures from doing it. So we would want him to prevent. I know there are times when persons say that, I can't go into that because I haven't studied that. But we've heard of cases where there was a particular case I remember where a young girl was walking in a lonely area, and this guy was in the bushes waiting to attack her. And then when he was about to make his move, he didn't see the young lady alone. He saw her with a man walking next to her. And then he attacked the next girl. But at the hearing, he said that he was going to attack her, but she had this man. And there was no one walking with her. So we could maybe from that believe that, yes, that God will intervene, but he did not, in doing that, he cannot interfere with your freedom of choice. Question two, why cannot God create those who freely do what is good? If God cannot do this, does it take away from his omnipotence and omnibenevolence? It isn't. Does it? Can he create persons who will only do good? And that was my friend Richard's argument, that God should create only those who will do good. Is that possible? It is not possible that God gives freedom and then make sure that we use it the right way. Now, when we use those two words, make sure, we can see that then our freedom is taken away, because if God has to make sure, he now is playing a role in my decision. He's making me do something that maybe I wouldn't have done if I had the freedom, the real freedom. That is not freedom. So God cannot make sure that persons do the right thing. He can't create you just to do the right thing. Once God gives freedom, it is beyond God's control. What occurs is not up to God, but it is up to the decision of free creatures. And one of the reasons that because God is omnipotent, he can do anything. God's omnipotence means being able to do things which are not only righteous, but are intrinsically possible. Let me read that again. God's omnipotence means being able to do things which are not only righteous, but are intrinsically possible. So, it's not possible to give freedom and withhold it at the same time. We can't do it. We can't give freedom and withhold it at the same time. Man or God cannot carry out two mutually exclusive alternatives. And this in no way questions his power. Doesn't mean because he can't do that he is less powerful. It is just impossible. It is just nonsensical. He cannot do those things. For God to have a world which is morally good, he must create free creatures on whom he must depend. It is thus the power of an omnipotent God is limited by the freedom he confers upon his creatures. So if God wants to have a world of morally good people, he has to depend on us to make the right choice. He has to depend on us to choose him.